Midtown Atlanta in Studio V. It's the 4th annual Starters Awards show. It's the Starties! And now, please welcome your host, Kristen Ledlow.
Good evening, and welcome to the Starters' 4th annual NBA Awards show, the Starties. I'm your host, Kristen Ledlow, and just like the Backstreet Boys, the Starters are back, handing out a bunch of tiny trophies to some very big players. Over the next hour, we'll give out all the major awards from Most Valuable Player to Sixth Man of the Year, plus a few winners and a few special categories, like a Meme of the Year and Funniest Moment. And later, we'll say a final goodbye to everything we lost this season, so prepare in advance to have your heartstrings tugged. But what would the Starties be without the Starters? Another award show. No thanks. Here they are, Skeet, Stash, Trey, and Lee, gentlemen.
Thank you, Kristen. 4th time hosting.
Yeah.
You're the Billy Crystal of the Starties. You're a legend.
That's a compliment.
That's definitely a compliment. Thank you. All right, guys. I want to quickly remind you how the scoring works here for the major awards. We had an impartial panel pick the 4 nominees. Then all 4 of us made our votes, along with you, the Starters fans, on Twitter. Whoever scored the most number one votes wins the award. It's as simple as that. We got a whole lot of hardware to hand out tonight, so let's get right to our first award. Back to Kristen.
The process, the president, the homie, and, well, a guy named Buddy. They're not the most hyped rookie class of all time, but they have nicknames already. They're doing something right. Here's the nominees for Rookie of the Year. Malcolm Brogdon of the Milwaukee Bucks. Joel Embiid of the Philadelphia 76ers. His teammate, Dario Saric. And Buddy Hield of the Sacramento Kings. And the winner is Dario Saric of the Philadelphia 76ers.
The homie takes the Starties Rookie of the Year.
Definitely the best nickname.
Absolutely. Yeah, there were some good nicknames here, though. The breakdown when it came to the voting, well, we were sort of all over the map here. We had Trey and Lee going with Dario Saric. Myself and the fans went with the president in Malcolm Brogdon. The split there, by the way, the tiebreaker, if you will, it just goes to the Starters. If there's more Starters voting for you, that's a good thing. And Taz, you went with Joel Embiid, despite obviously the 31 games played. But why did you guys, Trey and Lee, go with the homie as Rookie of the Year?
Well, I think Joel Embiid was the best rookie of the first half. I think Saric was the best rookie of the second half. And for the full season, probably Malcolm Brogdon was the most consistent. But you look at the full numbers for the whole year, Dario Saric led all rookies in scoring once you throw out Joel Embiid, who just played 31 games, second in minutes, second in rebounding. He was really good for the entire year. He was just overshadowed a little bit in the first half of the season, I think, by his teammate.
He certainly benefited from when Joel Embiid went down. Actually, that's when Saric really picked up his game. So even though it wasn't a great season in the end for the Philadelphia 76ers, looking forward, they've got some good young talent. Obviously, Ben Simmons is going to come back as well next season. But I think Dario Saric proved he was worth the wait.
I thought Joel Embiid was the best player this season. As you guys said, you always got to throw a caveat out. Dario Saric was good because Joel Embiid only played 31 games. And frankly, I'm stubborn. We said that he was the best rookie until he got injured. And I just don't think that the games played was compensated for by Dario Saric or Malcolm Brogdon. There was just too big a gap between number one and number two. So I just went with Joel Embiid. He was the best, went with it. Who cares about the
Despite
numbers?
Despite the 31 games,
I know,
they played
less than
800 minutes.
Yeah. I'm totally fine going with Dario Saric or Malcolm Brogdon. I went with the best, and I didn't think the gap was just too big for me.
All right, next award, Kristen.
They say defense is half the game. Makes sense. They also say that defense wins championships. So with these 4 guys in the mix, I guess that means you're already halfway there, right? Here's the nominees for Defensive Player of the Year. Rudy Gobert of the Utah Jazz. Draymond Green of the Golden State Warriors. Kawhi Leonard of the San Antonio Spurs. And Hassan Whiteside of the Miami Heat. The winner is Rudy Gobert of the Utah Jazz.
Eiffel Tower picks up the Defensive Player of the Year, Starty. We'll get to the voting breakdown in a second, but Gobert was kind enough to send in this acceptance speech.
Shout out to the Starters for the Defensive Player of the Year trophy. I really appreciate it. Thanks for the support, and go Jazz.
Oh, he throws in a go Jazz there at the end. So here's the breakdown. A whole lot of us going with Rudy Gobert. The fans included. Excuse me, the fans taking Kawhi Leonard, but the three of us here, besides Tass, who went with Draymond Green. I picked Rudy Gobert in the preseason. I'm sticking with him here ultimately, of course, and giving him the startie. I think he passes the eye test when it comes to him playing defense and obviously being the backbone of that very good Jazz defense. And, you know, when you look at the defensive statistics, when you really dig in there, your geeky awards or stats, so to speak, you know, blocks per game, that's an obvious one, but also leading the league in defensive real plus minus. It's huge. When he's out there, his team is just better defensively, as well as defensive win shares. That's enough to me. He's also a great defensive rebounder too, of course. So only missing one game, that was enough though. You know, Draymond Green, it feels like he's going to be snubbed in this again.
It's quite possible, yeah, for sure. Rudy Gobert has been spectacular. I picked Draymond Green because he's a little better 1-5. You know, the NBA is so much about picks on the outside, getting that big, moving. I think Draymond Green is a little bit better out on the perimeter. We saw that clip there where he stole the ball from Marc Gasol out there on the perimeter. He's just so perfect at corralling guys out there, and he's obviously immovable in the post. He's just a little bit better everywhere, I think, than Rudy Gobert, although Gobert is spectacular, and the Warriors' defense is a little bit better than the Utah Jazz.
One thing about Rudy Gobert is people say, well, he doesn't protect the perimeter like he does protect the rim, but he does actually deter a lot of guys from even going in there, and that's an incredible stat that you can't really quantify, because guys will see him there and they go, well, I'm not even going to bother trying to drive because I know that when I get there, this guy's going to turn away the shot. So it's one of those things that Draymond certainly gets more credit for that, but I think Rudy's overall sort of protection of the hoop and those around him has had a little bit more impact. Yeah. Having said that, Draymond, as always, has been such a backbone to that incredible Warriors
And he's
defense.
Great by the rim,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, he is very good. Yeah.
Absolutely. All right, Kristen, our next award.
Fans. They keep you cool, they dry your hands, and in another sense, they inspire your team to victory. They're so versatile, and thankfully, like the Andersons, these fans got tickets to the game. Guys, why don't you take me through the nominees for Fan of the Year?
Yes, absolutely. Our nominees for Fan of the Year, we start with the courtside culprit. Just popping. Scotty Brooks in the face there. He's so pumped up.
This one's a different fan. During the slam dunk contest, it disappointed some, including legend Dikembe Mutombo. Watch him shake his head.
Delete.
Didn't like that.
Delete.
Just give me an Instagram story I can use.
I love this Fan of the Year nominee. This very happy deli girl, we'll call her. It's so excited to see Matthew Dellavedova up close. Just in shock. Oh my gosh, that's
I reacted
him.
The same way the first time I saw him.
And the legend, Warriors Dance Mom. She had a spectacular year.
Yeah, she was everywhere.
She just took over.
What moves?
All right. So.
Is there a winner here? Yes, there in fact is. And it is the Warriors Dance Mom.
Wow.
All right. I think that's well deserved.
Mm-hmm. She put her heart and soul into this season.
And she too was kind enough to send in a quick acceptance speech. Warriors Dance Mom.
Basketball is a fast-paced game and it can turn around in seconds. That's what makes it so much fun. So I hope my crazy dancing has added to everyone's enjoyment of the game. Thank you again.
Oh yeah!
I was hoping she was gonna bust a move. Shoulder moves down pat.
Yeah, she understands that when you're on camera, they are only seeing you from the shoulders up, so that's what you gotta emphasize with your dance moves.
Oh man, she's still got it.
I love that she probably sleeps in this sweater.
Coming up next, we've got the award for the sixth man, and of course, the year's best wedgie.
Starties is brought to you by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey, proud partner of the NBA. Do your friends proud. Please drink responsibly.
Welcome back to the Starties. There are five starters on a basketball court and four on a TV show, even though I've told them I'm available. But if you think that's all it takes to be a champion, you are sorely mistaken. You need producers, directors, award show hosts, and a bunch of points off the bench. So these four guys take care of at least that last thing, and they're your nominees for the sixth man of the year. Eric Gordon of the Houston Rockets. Enes Kanter of the OKC Thunder. Zach Randolph of the Memphis Grizzlies. And Lou Williams of the Houston Rockets. Your winner is Lou Williams of the Houston Rockets.
Ooh! Taking home the Starty for Sixth Man of the Year. I feel a little dirty about this one, I gotta be honest.
Why is that?
About this category and even our nominees. Well, because here's the thing. Andre Iguodala probably should have been a nominee. But last year, and you see, most of us taking Williams, the fans say Eric Gordon. Outside of Lee last year, we all had Andre Iguodala as our Sixth Man of the Year. He should have won it last year. He really should have on a 73-win team, so I get why some people may be upset why he's not there now. So to me, it came down to Rocket versus Rocket in Lou and Gordon, and Lou's had the better season despite joining them halfway through.
I feel far dirtier not giving it to Eric Gordon because Lou really? Williams came to the Rockets and took his award and joined him as a teammate and took his award. If it was a comeback player of the year, I would give it to Eric Gordon because he has just found his way again in the NBA. I used to consider him potentially the second best shooting guard in the league when he was a Los Angeles Clipper, that he had that potential, sort of lost his way in New Orleans, now back with the Houston Rockets. I don't think Lou Williams will actually win the real award.
No, I don't think so either.
Eric Gordon has some serious potential, and so does Andre Iguodala to win the actual award.
Don't feel too dirty about it, guys. Lou Williams is still the best bench scorer in the league. He was leading the league in points off the bench when he was on the Lakers. Then when he got traded, he outplayed Eric Gordon in the second half of the season. More points, more assists, and a better field goal percentage. It's fine to vote for Lou Williams, even though he might technically be their seventh man.
This is Lou Williams' career, though, isn't it? He's like a Jamal Crawford. He's always going to come off the bench, and he's really good at doing it, because when you come off the bench, coaches want a guy to go out there and fill it up, and that's what he gets you. He gets you buckets. He's going to have those nights where he, you know, goes 0 for 10, that's fine. But most of the time, he's a pretty reliable guy to come out and just score a few baskets and also run the offense when he needs to.
Fans going with Eric Gordon, looking at the almost 250 threes made that Gordon splashed this year, 65% of his shot attempts are from three. He sits out there, lets Harden create, finds him, and shoots it. He plays his role perfectly, knocked in a whole bunch. It is a bit of a comeback for him.
Yeah, most games since his rookie year.
For sure.
So he's back.
For sure. All right, next award, Kristen.
Well, they may not include me in the starting lineup, but Commissioner Adam Silver said recently that it wouldn't be long before a woman becomes a head coach in the NBA. So, you know, before we take over the league, here's your male nominees for Coach of the Year. Mike D'Antoni of the Houston Rockets. Greg Popovich of the San Antonio Spurs. Brad Stevens of the Boston Celtics. And Eric Spoelstra of the Miami Heat. The winner is Mike D'Antoni of the Houston Rockets.
Another award for the Rockets here on the Starties. Makes sense. Heck of a year for the Houston Rockets. And we actually have a quick acceptance speech here from Coach D'Antoni himself.
Hey, starters, you know, you guys are great. I appreciate this. It means a lot. So continue the good work.
Yep. He knows the show. He knows the show.
This one, I mean, really came down to the fans' decision because we were all over the board here. Trey went with D'Antoni, our eventual winner. Lee, Brad Stevens, Taz, Greg Popovich, myself, Eric Spoelstra, and the fans siding with Trey. So D'Antoni takes home the award.
Yeah, I've always said we have the smartest fans in the business. But seriously, Mike D'Antoni really changed the culture for the Houston Rockets. Last year, they were not a fun team to watch. There was a lot of dysfunction in the locker room. This year, he comes in. He's a perfect fit for James Harden. He's a perfect fit with Daryl Morey. They brought in the right kind of players to put around him and just let James Harden be the best kind of player he can be. All those things, to me, factor into who's going to be your coach of the year. And I also think that the Rockets surprised a lot of people. You know, they were a borderline playoff team coming into the season. Mm-hmm. They finished with the third best record in the league.
Yeah, well, I ultimately went with Brad Stevens because he got the Celtics to the top of the Eastern Conference. They came in with big expectations. 50 wins was certainly on their agenda, and he was able to do that and exceed that. And now they have home court advantage throughout the first round of throughout the entire Eastern Conference playoffs. Just because it's only 53 wins shouldn't be a knock on him that it's not a 60-win team or anything like that. I think he gets the most out of the players as much as he can because they are a flawed team, the Celtics, but still they work together, they play for their coach, and ultimately I think it's his award.
I took the one guy, obviously, from our nominees here who didn't even make the playoffs, and Eric Spoelstra with the Miami Heat. But what he did with that squad after the 11-30 start to get them to go 30-11 over the second half of the season, that's mind-boggling. It was the best second-half record ever by a team that missed the playoffs. You can put that on the Nets for sitting all their guys. Maybe they would have beaten the Bulls and the Heat would have gone in there. But they lost Chris Bosh in training camp. Eric Spoelstra was a huge part of rejuvenating the careers of guys like James Johnson. And Deion Waiters included in that. So I had to give a little bit of love to Spoelstra despite not making the playoffs.
There's lots of great nominees. So let me say my piece for Greg Popovich. We don't talk about him enough when we talk about Coach of the Year. He's the best coach, but we never give him Coach of the Year. And this may have been his best coaching performance. Tim Duncan leaves. They still maintained a great defense. I don't know how it happened.
That's the craziest thing.
It is crazy because you've got David Lee and Pau Gasol playing the big, and Dwayne Dedman, sort of a journeyman type guy there. Some way, somehow, he gets it done. It was a phenomenal performance. And to say that this may be his best performance ever is something. You know, another 60-win team.
Sure. Kristen, our next award.
Yeah, a basketball game is like life. It happens so fast that sometimes it's difficult to appreciate all of it. That is why we honor the wedgie. It allows us to stop, to take a moment and reflect on the beauty around us. Tess, I'm going to let you take us through the nominees for Wedgie of the Year.
Let's look at these snowflakes. This block wedgie by Dorian Finney-Smith. Look at that. That one's a beauty.
Stick it.
Hard block there. The can't pick it wedgie. DeMar DeRozan sticks it. Watch how deep this baby goes. You can't get it out. Nope. Try again.
That's deep.
It ain't coming out.
It's such a soft shot, too.
Watch Isaiah Thomas on this next one. It's the gotta see it wedgie. Takes his shot. He wants to see it so bad he runs underneath the rim just to get a better look. And our producer wanted some star power, so we got Isaiah Thomas in there. And here is the controversial wedgie. This is Goran Dragic after the buzzer, so it actually didn't count, but it makes our list because we had Senior Vice President of Replay and Referee Operations, Joe Borgia, on the show to tell us, no wedgie, no wedgie. That's why it makes the list.
Well, the winner here is... All right, Dorian Finney-Smith with the block wedgie.
Wow.
It was incredible. And here's the man who made that block happen, the Mavs, Dorian Finney-Smith.
Thank you for the Wedgie of the Year Award. I want to say thank you guys, and I'm cherish this moment.
I thought it was an impressive block wedgie.
Defensive wedgie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but that was just a hard block. We don't usually get that type of block wedgie.
Yeah, he hits it off the glass and it still sticks into the rim somehow. It doesn't make sense. Great choice.
The wedgie gods want us to get the goal
That's
of 50.
Right.
We are four away from the magical number of 50 wedgies.
Yeah.
The playoffs are long. There are a lot of games. We only need four.
Yeah, we're almost at that modern day set record of 47 a couple years ago.
Well, coming up next, we're going to hand out the award that, no one wants. It's the worst of the year. Welcome back to the Starties. We have already handed out 6 awards, but there's still plenty to come, including the winner of this season's Most Valuable Player trophy. Nick Young, Lance Stephenson, Michael Jordan. Not only legendary basketball players, also legendary internet memes. And these 4 ballers are trying to get on that level. They're this season's nominees for Meme of the Year, guys.
White House Press Secretary Sean Spicer dropped an alternative facts line about Trump's inauguration crowd, and the NBA loved it.
Sean Spicer will be talking about my magic career any second now. Yeah, 14,000 points, greatest player in Magic history.
What happened the last couple of weeks?
Well, yes, you know.
Actually, we won all those games. I'm going with that alternative fact thing.
Even NBA TV going with the alternative stats when it came to a Lakers-Mavericks box score.
Hashtag raise the cat happened when the Sixers were at the peak of their season. They were winning basketball games. They had cats on their shoulders, as Ben Simmons did right here. And then after every win, fans were taking photos of themselves with their cats. Hashtag raise the cat. Look at all these cats. And then rookie Ben Simmons got in on it as well, raising his cats. And then the fantastic meme.
Russell Westbrook strolling into his first matchup versus Durant, rocking the bright orange photographer vest. And the photoshops, they started flying. We had Taylor Swift lyrics. We had your classic crying Jordan meme. Just a straight up pizza emoji.
Delicious.
Everybody loves pizza. J. Cole went double platinum with no features. We were just mashing memes together here. Garfield because it was orange, I guess. And the Starters logo. Just
nice work,
works
Trey.
Well with the vest.
Last one here, the water bottle challenge. Everyone was doing it, including the Cavs, during a basketball game. This is the fourth quarter of a romp over the Knicks. Guys just tossing a water bottle around. LeBron was missing.
On the court.
But watch Kyrie Irving here. He's going to hit it. Listen for the buzzer.
Oh,
he's so clutch.
The winner, though they all are. What do I love more than cats? Russell Westbrook.
Russell Westbrook takes the meme of the year. I think it makes sense. I think it does. Just with the type of season he had, and it was that battle, of course, against Kevin Durant, and all eyes were on that game, and in he walks with the official photographer.
That was awesome.
Coincidence, he said.
Oh, yes, it was a coincidence. Not that KD's really into photography. No, just a complete coincidence. All right, guys. Well, look, it's not all highlight reel dunks here on the Starters. We, and when I mean we, I really mean Lee, also honor the fundamental plays of the game, such as good ball movement and teamwork. I still don't really know what constitutes a very solid play, but Lee does, so here are the nominees for VSP.
Heading down to the fortress for the first one, and it's a fortress fizzer from the Atlanta Hawks. This has got everything that a very solid play likes. His pump fake parties, his bounce passes, the ball fizzing around, it ends with a corner.
Swish ball.
Oh, yes, it does. A similar play here from the Cleveland Cavaliers. This one's called the Cleveland Clinic, down at the fortress too.
Ooh.
Once again, great ball movement. Little bit of a pump fake party, ends in the corner with another
swish ball.
Yes. And it wouldn't be a very solid play without the San Antonio Spurs, of course. This is the passport play, ending with Patty Mills in the corner for a three. And sometimes it can be just a beautiful pass, as it was this time from Nikola Jokic with a slingshot pass. But the winner
is the Cleveland Clinic.
Whoa!
Deserved.
Yes, it was a beautiful play, and here to accept the award on behalf of the Cavs, point guard Kyrie Irving.
It was a very solid play.
What does it mean to you, though, to, you know, everyone likes the dunks and the high-flying plays, but to get, like, a play that rewards fundamental basketball?
It's just a testament of the team, by the way. Love your show.
We love the show you put on for us, too, man.
I appreciate that. And I'm glad that we can just be fundamentally sound as a team, take it upon ourselves to make the extra pass. And, you know, glad that we got the very solid player of the year for 2017 with the Starties. So I appreciate that.
There it is.
Very solid acceptance speech, too.
You're absolutely right.
We're not done, though, with a very solid play, because as you also know, I like to compile the stats throughout the year. And I get some help from my friend Kaushik out in Melbourne. And here are the stats.
Like he does it all.
He does, yes. This is all the different types of plays that we have.
What's the big one?
The big one there is the ball fizzing around.
Oh, yeah.
Classic. You say that a lot, right?
And also, there's one more graph that he likes to compile, and it's the does Skeets like it? And wow, Skeets, what a year you've had. Yes.
I do like it.
Apparently so. Apparently you like more of them than you didn't like.
I think we need to check the tape on that. All right, great stuff.
All right, it's time to hand out the honor no one wants, the Worst of the Year Award. Past recipients include Donald Sterling and Dwight Howard, but recently it's been more of a blessing to receive this dishonor. It's almost a reverse 2K curse. J.R. Smith and Dion Waiters have found their way, so there's hope for the Kings. But this year, undoubtedly, the winner of this anti-award is the New York Knicks. President Phil Jackson and Carmelo Anthony butted heads, social media accounts, all season long. That's where they held most of their meetings. Jackson told CBS Melo holds the ball too much. Melo responded by saying he'd be the bigger person and let it go. On Instagram, see, I let it go, world. An article portraying Anthony as a player who just doesn't want it enough was written by Bleacher Report. And the president of the team Melo plays on co-signed it by tweeting something about leopards and potentially peyote. Not really sure. The media wouldn't stop churning out the stories, and no one in the organization snuffed them out. Is Phil trying to trade Melo? Does Melo want to leave? Will he waive his no trade clause? No, he's going to be stubborn and stay. The Knicks even broke the rules by talking about and angering other teams' players. Like when Phil Jackson inexplicably told ESPN a tale about LeBron as a member of the Heat while visiting the Cavs, that LBJ wanted to stay overnight with his mom and quote, posse. The word posse and its racial connotation rightfully bothered LeBron and his business partner, Maverick Carter. They voiced their displeasures publicly, but Phil stayed quiet for weeks after telling a story about two teams he wasn't affiliated with, and never affiliated with. undercutting the most powerful player in the NBA probably won't help attract free agents to NY. There was the night where Derrick Rose disappeared. He didn't show up to a game and didn't tell anyone he wasn't coming. He vanished. He apparently hit up Joakim Noah's phone sometime in the second half. Noah's rejuvenation attempt did not go well, and it ended with a 20-game suspension for an over-the-counter supplement geared toward injury recovery. In January, Courtney Lee said he didn't take a game-winning shot attempt because the assistant coach of the opposing team was on the floor, and Lee thought he was a player. On the court, everything was a mess. Kristaps Porzingis said there was a lot of confusion and everything was just unclear. Players, including Dee Rose, publicly complained, starting after game one, about the offensive system. And no one seemed to back head coach Jeff Hornacek. Sometimes Hornacek couldn't even bear to watch. After Brandon Jennings was released and signed by Washington, he said he was now with a team that actually plays together. You think things couldn't get worse? Madison Square Garden security says, hold my beer. During a nationally televised game, Knicks legend Charles Oakley did some scuffling with officers, was thrown to the ground, and arrested. The optics couldn't have been worse if they tried. The PR press release on the Notes app, ugh, it was very sad. And all that triangle talk throughout the season, I don't want to come off as obtuse, but isosceles this coming. Stop trying to be acute, Tess. Ugh. All things being equilateral, the Knicks are even ruining my pristine reputation for hilarious jokes. That's how bad it is. Four straight years of missing out on the postseason. First time a team did the water bottle challenge against them. And now I can't wait to stop talking about the Knicks. The New York Knicks, your worst of the year.
So well deserved, mm-hmm. so well deserved. Mm. It's time to raise the banner to the rafters here in the starter studio. Mm. Let's hope no Nick goes missing this summer. Let's hope Frank Isola can write about another sport like tennis or soccer perhaps. Let's hope Joakim Noah.
What a performance.
Gets healthy. And if you listen to Phil Jackson's end of the season news conference, maybe Carmelo Anthony will be in another place next year. This is a strange, strange situation. Well deserved, but let's stop talking about them.
Mm, well, at least they won something.
Yep, they did. I mean, they did. All right, coming up after this break, it's the most improved player of the year and the funniest moment, it wasn't Lee's shoes, of the 2016-17 season. You're watching The Starties, presented by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey.
Starties is brought to you by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey, proud partner of the NBA. Do your friends proud. Please drink responsibly.
Welcome back to the Starties. Someone once said you're either getting better or you're getting worse. Brilliant. Not only did this year's nominees for Most Improved Player get better, they got a lot better, which is better than getting worse. Here's the nominees. Giannis Antetokounmpo of the Milwaukee Bucks. Harrison Barnes of the Dallas Mavericks. James Johnson of the Miami Heat. And Nikola Jokic of the Denver Nuggets. And the winner is... the Greek Freak, Giannis Antetokounmpo.
No surprise here. The Greek Freak taking home the Starty for Most Improved Player. Here's a quick look at the voter breakdown. Everybody taking the Greek Freak, except for Lee, who went with the Joker. But here is Giannis to accept the award for Most Improved Player.
Tas Mellas 2 years ago said the most overrated player in the NBA, Giannis Antetokounmpo. Now, 2017, two years after, most improved player. In the NBA, from the
stars.
So I appreciate that. Thank you, guys.
You've inspired him, Tess!
That is great stuff. I thought Yanni's oh, by myself joke was great, but that was even better. Yasur Yanni. I just called him overrated again. No, I didn't. No, I did not. I was just trying to put people in their place. Anyways, that's in the past. He's phenomenal.
Well deserved.
He's only going to get better from here. I think we know as a 22-year-old, he's getting to the rim more than anyone in the league. I think people overlook that. He can get to the rim, and everyone knows he has trouble shooting now. Like, he shoots at the rim more than LeBron, more than Westbrook. So when he adds that jump shot, which I don't think there's any doubt he will, because this is year four in the league. Mm-hmm. He came out of the second-tier Greek league.
Now he's a superstar in this league.
Right.
So he's going to add that shot. He's going to add that three-point shot. No one can stop him now. Think about a few years from now, and we'll be calling Yanni MVP, perhaps.
I think he wrapped up this win in, like, the first week of the season. He was putting up, like, 24-9-7 with a steal per game, two blocks per game through, like, the first five games, and everyone was like, whoa, this guy took the next step. And I think that's always the most difficult thing to do, to go from good, which is what he was, to great, all-star, very likely all NBA. I mean, that's impressive.
Bucks in the playoffs.
Bucks in the playoffs, too, on a good team. Yeah. That's absolutely right. So well-deserved. And I love that you inspired him. I like that he's still remembering.
I'm pretty sure he inspired himself.
No, every night he goes to bed just saying your name. Tess, yeah. Tess, I love it. All right, next award, Kristen.
Basketball, a gorgeous game with graceful athleticism, intricate schemes, and moments of true sporting perfection. It's also hilarious when none of that happens and it all goes wrong. So these four nominees for the funniest moment had things go wrong in the best possible way, guys.
Yes, our first nominee, it's Jeff.
Oh, Jeff.
Falling on his head trying to do a backflip for the Suns dance team. He was okay, guys.
Our next nominee, Kemba, gets swaggy. He pulls a Nick Young, celebrating before the shot goes in. He thinks it's done.
Sam Decker in Madison Square Garden. That's not how you run a fast break. Ball off the face.
And it was the year of Westbrook, including this blunder. He just walks and eventually gets called for a travel. What?
Six, seven steps.
What? He turns around like
Colin plays.
Yeah. Just forgot to dribble.
Yeah. All right, good nominees.
And the winner is... Oh, Swaggy K, Kemba Walker.
Oh! I mean, a good moment.
A great moment.
Very funny. Yeah. And, like, the shimmy really sells.
Yeah. It's like a three-step shimmy.
Yeah.
But my man Jeff was robbed here.
I gotta agree. Jeff was probably robbed here. I think Kemba's getting the vote because his happened on a basketball court and he's a basketball player. But come on, Jeff! You got one chance to nail this backflip.
Yeah, I mean,
got a separated shoulder.
You would think that he wouldn't do this unless he was totally confident he was able to nail it. Like,
well, he's probably done it before.
I don't know if he has.
That day.
I'm not sure, but Kemba Walker takes the funniest moment of the year. All right, guys. Well, from the highest of the highs there with funniest moment, we now turn to the lowest of the lows for our next segment. And to get us into that, I'll go back to Kristen.
And just like with any NBA season, there are highs and lows, good and bad, wedgies and air balls. So please, grab a tissue and join Skeets, Tass, Trey, and Lee as they say goodbye to this season's dearly departed.
Promises you would stay, promises of yesterday, that you'd be here forever. Now I can't hold you near, memories disappear, 'cause we can't be together.
They say, forget about the past, 'cause nothing good can last, but I can't say goodbye to you.
Just like a dream that you won't let die, like a prayer that you can't deny. Oh, I miss you. When the night falls and you can't hold on, when you hope but you know it's gone. Oh, I miss you.
Never been laid so low, having trouble letting go, holding on to the feeling. Never gonna turn my back, never gonna fade to black, never gonna stop believing.
Forget about the past, 'cause nothing good can last, but I can't say goodbye to you. just like a dream that you won't let die, like a prayer that you can't deny. Oh, I miss you.
When the night falls and you can't hold on, when you hope but you know it's gone, oh, I miss you. Oh, I miss you.
Welcome back to the Starties. It is time for the granddaddy of them all, the Beard, the Brody, the King and the Claw. They've all had dominant seasons, but who's been the most dominant? It's time to figure this out once and for all. The nominees for the most valuable player are James Harden of the Houston Rockets, LeBron James of the Cleveland Cavaliers, Kawhi Leonard of the San Antonio Spurs, and Russell Westbrook of the Oklahoma City Thunder. The winner is James Harden of the Houston Rockets.
The Beard gets MVP in the Starties. It's a debate we've been having since night one of the regular season.
Yep.
And here is the voting breakdown for most valuable player. Trey, Lee, and Tass, they go with the Beard and James Harden. Myself and the fans say Russell Westbrook. It's a split decision here in a way, but three starters say the Harden. Why do you guys go with James ultimately?
It's the best combination of individual numbers and team accomplishments for me. I think his numbers have been overshadowed because Russell Westbrook has this fancy title of triple-double, but you look at their numbers side by side, they're really comparable, very comparable. James Harden's numbers haven't been done since 1965. So you can argue that his numbers are actually better. Plus, second best offense versus the 17th best offense when you're talking about the Rockets and the Thunder. 8 more wins for the Rockets. To me, the assists are big. You know, those points per game that Russell has, it's on 5 more shots. So yeah, it's 2.5 more points, but I think the assist sort of makes up for it, a little bit more efficiency. I think overall that package is better than Russ's, LeBron's or Kawhi's, who all had fantastic seasons.
Yeah, I think Harden has just been a little tiny bit more efficient than Westbrook was. I think he's a little more unpredictable with the ball. He's made his teammates better, which I don't necessarily know that you would say about Russell Westbrook. I think it's also impressive that Harden, this is his first year as a point guard, and he came close to leading the league in scoring and assists. He just seems to be a perfect fit for the way they're playing right now. Maybe even a better fit for Mike D'Antoni's system than Steve Nash was, which seems crazy to even think about.
There is no wrong answer.
There's no
honestly,
wrong answer.
There's no wrong answer year. When it comes to this. And just because you take one guy doesn't mean you're knocking the other guys by any means. But when I went and I looked at most valuable player, I looked at the three words in most valuable player. Most, when it comes to Westbrook, well, he just gave us the most triple-doubles in a season in NBA history. Passing the big O. That is amazing. The most points in the season, as we showed you, nearly 32 a game. The most one-man comebacks that I can remember since watching Jordan, and his numbers in the clutch back that up. Then I look at valuable. This was a big part of it to me. I think Westbrook was more valuable to his team a little bit than Harden was, because Harden, when he's not out there, they're a mediocre team. When Russ was not out there, you check the on-off splits, when Russ was not out there on the floor, that Thunder team's a lottery team, and that's just a matter of fact. And then player, that was very, very subjective, but Russell Westbrook's a G. He's the most fun guy to watch in the NBA this season. He really was. He was eclectic. He's electric. Every night, night in, night out, he played nearly the entire season at full tilt. He was like a Red Bull version of Allen Iverson's 2001 MVP run. He was just cranked up to the max. So that's why I ultimately went with Westbrook.
Yeah. Both have incredible narratives as well. James Harden had, by his standards, a bad season last year. He bounced back and has got his team to third in the Western Conference. And Russell Westbrook, the question would he be able to carry a team without Kevin Durant? Well, he answered that. I mean, the Thunder have been fantastic this season. And now we get those two in the first round to battle off to see who advances to the second round of the playoffs, which is going to be great. But just seeing the way both of those dealt with the expectations and went out there and did make their teams better and just made their whole seasons look so much more fun for everyone who loves this game.
Yeah, Russ overwhelmed everyone. And I think he did it timed it perfectly as well. So I think the voters, the real ones, will end up going with him because he has a better storyline than James Harden just because there was all that drama. We talked about it in July and August and September about KD leaving him. And October, November, December, January, we're talking about him and what he did. It was sort of the year of anger for Russ. You know, Russ always plays angry, but I think there was a fire burning inside him a little bit more. And the way he closed games and closed out this season like he did there, that was a 50-point game. He just finished off there from 47 to 50 right there, and he eliminated the Nuggets. So there were some special, special moments.
You said, I mean, it was perfectly timed, sort of Westbrook's on late. I think that's true. They were racing, these two guys. And, yeah, Kawhi and LeBron were right there as well. Mm-hmm. But it was really a two-man race. And in any real race, whoever pulls away at the end is going to win the thing. Yeah. Timing is it comes into play. So I don't think he meant to time it this way. It just sort of worked out that way.
I think we still forget that this is a team game, though, and those should factor in. The fact that the Rockets are a better offensive team, you know, second again versus 17th offenses, and the eight more wins. It's a factor. It should be a factor. I think it is a team game.
You're right.
Last time I checked.
Like you said, Lee, we get to find out maybe which team's better, which player's better in the first round of the playoffs. Can't wait for that. All right, one more break. When we come back, it's time to count down the top 10 plays of the year. You're watching the Starties presented by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back to the Starties, guys. The awards have all been handed out, but one honor remains. I think the most important honor, and that is a place in the Starters' top 10 plays of the year. Is it a top 10 or is it a top 19? You know we cheat here on the Starters all the time. At number 10, it's a bunch of putback dunks.
Oh.
Gerald Green still got the hops. Dunking on Leonard.
Standing reservation in the top 10 plays of the year.
For sure. We're not done with the putbacks. Derrick Jones Jr., who we've compared before to Gerald Green and the hops, flying in out of nowhere.
Easy springs.
And one more. Why not? The unicorn. Kristaps Porzingis. There he is.
Oh.
Yes.
Soars in, slams it home in MSG, going nuts.
Man, sneaky.
Oh, that's just 10. That's just number 10.
He's so good at that. At number 9, Jonathan Simmons, this mean dunk on Myers Leonard. Leonard getting dunked on one more time. Ooh, I love watching this guy.
Yeah. Man.
At number 8, let's go back to Christmas Day. The Warriors and Cavs, Richard Jefferson. Yes, Richard Jefferson.
Did you go back to Christmas Day 2002?
No, this is 2016, Lee.
Fans are going nuts.
I miss Christmas.
People call this the dunk of the year, Larry Nance on Brooke Lopez. Because he dunked on Lopez and everyone on the court went nutty, including Timofey Mozgov, including the Brooklyn Nets bench, who he just dunked on. What a dunk.
At number 6, we got a pair of dunks here from James Johnson.
Ooh.
Thrunks it.
Man, that one looks painful.
Yeah.
Knee to the chest.
And Bloodsport, he wasn't done, yeah. Look away. He would get Steph Curry. Oh, Curry trying to take the charge. James Johnson trying to beat the buzzer. Throws it down.
Deals in the circle.
At number 5, 3 Giannis Antetokounmpo plays, gets the steal here. Watch this, windmill.
Oh man.
It's like he's on the ground when he finally dunks it.
He can almost touch the floor with his windmill.
Really can. Now the double clutch. That again, it looks like it's in slow-mo, sort of.
You just don't see
two
that,
dribbles
though.
And he's done up the court.
You know, a lot of people say, oh, we've never seen that before, but this is legitimate with this guy, sincere, because we haven't. Watch this from the elbow.
Oh, man.
He's dunking from the elbow. No big deal.
Nearly free throw line in a game.
The elbow dunk.
The Greek Freak got crazy. At number 4, it's old man Vince Carter with the reverse 360 layup.
Yeah, Vince.
He's like a young Vince Carter.
Yeah.
Come on.
Amazing, right?
Remember you tried doing this, Lee?
I think I did.
No, you didn't even come close.
No.
At number 3, 3 Wolves dunks from their big 3. Cat giving it to Brooke Lopez.
Just say it, Lee.
Oh, Katmandu.
There it is.
Yeah.
Final time this year.
Thankfully, yeah. Monstrous dunk from Andrew Wiggins. A huge jam. And then his partner in crime, Zach LaVine. Get well soon, Zach. Smooth on Alex Len. He just lined him up. Oh, I see you there.
That's his best in-game dunk.
Yeah.
Of his very young career.
Sure.
Yeah. at number two. Beautiful play here from the Warriors. Draymond up ahead to Steph, who throws it over his head to the trailing Kevin Durant.
It's had to run nice. A fast break.
This is gorgeous. Should have been a very solid play.
Oh my. Oh my.
And at number one, the man who provided us with so many highlights. 7 seconds left, up three. He chooses to dunk. Could have pulled out, nah. That's not his style. Uh-uh. Foul, no.
Oh, hefty.
Offhand.
That's well. My MVP.
He dunks on the Rockets. And coming up court, a pass through the wickets of Corey Joseph. Did he mean to?
Doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter. Nutmegs him from 40.
And then the game winner versus Denver to give him 50 points and to put Denver away for the regular season. This killed their playoff hopes.
What a way to finish.
Yeah.
So there
phenomenal
it is.
Year.
The top 10 plays of the year, but really top 19, 18, wow. whatever.
Top a lot.
All right. Yeah.
Close enough.
Had a great year.
Yeah.
And what an exciting evening of NBA awards magic. Have fun, everybody. Drive safe. Taz, take us home.
Thanks for joining us, everybody. And please join us every weeknight during the postseason. We'll break down all the playoff games. And remember, voting is a privilege, not a right.
Race the night, people.